です、です、です、です。です、です、です、です、です、です、です。です、です、です、です、です、テスト、テスト、です、です、です。です、です、です、です、です。
This committee will come to order. Pursuant to notice, we meet today to mark up three measures. As member offices were notified yesterday, in view of the six concurrent committee markups taking place right now and the broad support for the items that we're considering here, the ranking member and I intend to consider en bloc all three measures together with the amendments that were provided to you previously. And so without objection, the following items, which all members have before them, are considered read and will be considered en bloc. H.R. 1771, the North Korea Sanctions Enforcement Act, Royce Amendment Number 29 in the nature of a substitute to that H.R. 1771, the Castro Second Degree Amendment Number 33 to H.R. 1771, expressing the sense of Congress on enforcement of relevant U.N. Security Council resolutions, the Connolly Second Degree Amendment Number 118, to H.R. 1771, requiring progress on reunification of separated Korean families, including for Korean Americans. H.R. 4449, the Human Trafficking Prevention Act, and House Resolution 600 regarding the upcoming presidential runoff election in Afghanistan. So without objection, all members may have 5 days to submit statements for the record and any extraneous materials on today's items, and after an opening remarks by myself and by the ranking member Elliot Engel, I'll be glad to recognize any member seeking recognition to speak on the en bloc items. So beginning with our legislation on North Korea, that country remains one of the greatest threats due to the fact that they are developing nuclear weapons, and given the attitude of Kim Jong-un, one of the greatest threats, not just to the United States, but to our allies in Northeast Asia. The dictators of North Korea have repeatedly defied the international community's efforts to dismantle the nuclear program there. For years, North Korea has repeatedly dangled the promise of nuclear disarmament and dismantlement of their program in order to get existing sanctions eased. It has been 6 years since North Korea walked away from the negotiating table. The only thing that has changed since 2008 is that North Korea is closer to miniaturizing a nuclear warhead. Our North Korea policy, frankly, has been a bipartisan failure. Last year, when we held a hearing on North Korea, it had just completed its third nuclear test, and it had successfully launched a three-stage intercontinental ballistic missile. Today, reports show that North Korea may soon conduct a fourth nuclear test. The administration says that its North Korea policy remains one of strategic patience. It is now time for Congress to lead by providing a clear legislative framework for sanctions to deprive Kim Jong-un of his ability to build nuclear weapons, and to deprive him of his ability to repress and abuse the North Korean people. The North Korea Sanctions Enforcement Act seeks to apply the same type of pressure that the Treasury Department successfully applied in 2005 when it targeted a small bank in Macau that was complicit in Pyongyang's counterfeiting. This was the Bank of Delta Asia. This impact sent a ripple throughout the international financial system. If you'll recall, 10 other banks complied once Banco Delta Asia was named, and as a consequence, hard currency was cut off from North Korea. It seriously crimped the financing there. It stopped the ability for them to continue their buildup on their missile program. It made it impossible for the dictator there to pay his generals, which is never a good position for a dictator to be in. So this was one of the most effective steps we've taken against North Korea. It lasted in place, as I recall, about 8 months until the State Department brought significant pressure on Treasury, and this was under the Bush administration. State was interested in getting them lifted in the hopes that that would then get North Korea to the table. Of course, those negotiations proved to be fruitless. And we lost the ability at that time for the one thing that had held in check, the ability of the regime to continue on its program. This legislation we have with us today enables our government to go after Kim Jong-un's illicit activities, just like we went after organized crime in our own country. And it does so by interdicting shipments and disrupting the flow of money. And these sanctions target North Korea's money laundering. Just as in 05, it was a case of them counterfeiting $100 bills that got us to the point where sanctions were put in place. They're involved in money laundering. They're involved in counterfeiting. Of course, they're involved in illicit smuggling and narcotics trafficking, for those who have watched the way in which the regime gets the lion's share of its hard currency. And there is a focus on North Korea's deplorable human rights violations in this legislation by targeting those officials responsible specifically for torture, for the gulags, for the extrajudicial killings that are sadly a fact of life in North Korea today. So this bipartisan piece of legislation has over 135 co-sponsors. It's garnered the support of humanitarian groups worldwide, and humanitarian aid is in no way affected, I should note, for the members here. Second, we go to H.R. 4449, the Human Trafficking Prevention Act, and this seeks to ensure that U.S. personnel overseas are properly equipped to perceive and combat the scourge of human trafficking. Though current law requires the State Department personnel be trained to identify trafficking victims, it does not prescribe minimum training requirements. This bill does that. It adds some of these specifics, which I think are important: a training course for department personnel who deal with trafficking issues, trafficking briefings of all the ambassadors and deputy chiefs of mission before they depart to their post, so they know their responsibilities in this regard, annual reminders to personnel regarding key trafficking issues related to their countries of focus. As you know, we've made significant changes in the law, and we want to make sure that they're enforcing it. So let me see if we have some additional notes here. Lastly, we have House Resolution 600, which urges the government of Afghanistan to pursue a transparent, credible, and inclusive runoff presidential election. I thank Mr. Grayson of Florida for his work on this timely resolution. Less than 2 months ago, Afghans overwhelmingly flocked to the polls to vote in presidential and provisional elections. Now, I think this is interesting. More than 7 million Afghan citizens cast a ballot during the first round of voting. That dwarfs the 4.5 million who voted in 2009. Although the April elections were a significant improvement, there is still progress to be made. Numerous electoral complaints led to the invalidation of votes in certain precincts, and just last week, Afghanistan's Independent Election Commission fired poll workers who were accused of voter fraud. This resolution urges the government of Afghanistan to lessen the risk of fraud, to improve electoral transparency, to enhance security efforts, and increase voter participation during the upcoming runoff. Importantly, it also recognizes the sacrifices of the members of our armed forces and underscores that this election will contribute to the security and stability interests of both Afghanistan and of the United States. Afghans will finally select a successor to President Karzai on June the 14th. This election offers the chance for a fresh start with a new president and will allow Afghans to create a new and better era. We now go to Mr. Elliot Engel of New York for his opening comments, the ranking member.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for holding this markup and for, the bipartisan collaboration on the three measures before us today. I'd like to begin by commending you for your hard work on the North Korea Sanctions Enforcement Act and for your longstanding commitment to address the grave threat posed by North Korea. I've been there twice. It doesn't make me an expert, but once you step foot in that country, you realize something is terribly wrong. This bill would broaden U.S. sanctions against those helping sustain the regime in Pyongyang, whose crimes against humanity, the U.N. Human Rights Office says, are, and I quote, without parallel in the modern world, unquote. The North Korean regime is no stranger to sanctions, and it's clear why. Development of nuclear weapons, arms smuggling, transnational crime. To me, however, the brutal repression of the North Korean people, above all, warrants the enactment of this legislation. With this bill, Congress labels North Korea's supporters as equally responsible for the horrors imposed by Kim Jong-un and his cronies on the North Korean people. This measure provides broader and tougher sanctions against North Korea's illicit activities. It gives the President flexibility to use the authorities in this act most effectively, and it carefully avoids any interference with the relief organizations providing food, medicine, and other humanitarian aid to the North Korean people. That's the irony. The United States has been the strongest and the greatest provider of food, medicine, and other humanitarian aid to the North Korean people, while their brutal regime kills their own people and vilifies the United States. This bill is aimed at those few around the world who have chosen to remain morally blind to the crimes of the North Korean state. I urge all of our colleagues to support it. I want to commend our colleague, Mr. Connolly, who has been relentless in urging passage of this legislation. Indeed, he's been relentless in terms of everything involving the repression in North Korea. He was speaking to me about it, urging us to pass it, working with us on it to help stop the North Korean regime. And I want to publicly thank Mr. Connolly for his strong support and his help with this legislation. Mr. Chairman, I also support H.R. 4449, a bill introduced by my colleague from New York, Representative Sean Patrick Maloney. This legislation would expand training requirements for federal governmental personnel, including employees of the State Department, on identifying and preventing human trafficking. Human trafficking is modern-day slavery, and its victims are robbed of their freedom and dignity. This crime spans the globe, driving profits of up to $32 billion a year. Best estimates tell us that as many as 27 million people are victims of human trafficking, many coerced into forced labor or commercial sex with no means of escape. One of the best ways to stop this crime is to make sure people know it when they see it. This bill would provide comprehensive, mandatory training and special briefings on human trafficking for embassy reporting officers, regional bureaus, trafficking in persons coordinators, and their superiors. It would also keep our State Department and other federal government personnel up to speed on the key problems, threats, methods, and warning signs of human trafficking specific to their country or post. Mr. Chairman, we need to remember that people, not policies, are often the first line of defense against modern slavery, and this legislation will better prepare our diplomats and other public servants to spot this crime and take action as they serve at their diplomatic posts abroad. So I urge my colleagues to support this important legislation as well. And finally, I support a resolution on the presidential election in Afghanistan that was introduced by our colleague, Representative Grayson. On April 5th, the people of Afghanistan went to the polls. We saw incredible courage that day from the candidates, the poll workers, and all those who have braved countless acts of violence and intimidation because they wanted their voices to be heard. Afghanistan's Independent Election Commission recently announced that none of the candidates garnered more than 50% of the vote, so the commission scheduled a runoff election for June 14th. The Afghans should be proud of their electoral system, civil society, media, and security forces for carrying out a successful first round of voting. Let me also congratulate the two leading vote recipients, Dr. Abdullah Abdullah and Dr. Ashraf Ghani. This runoff represents another step forward for the people of Afghanistan. The future of their country is in their hands. And as this resolution conveys, it is critical that this runoff election be credible, inclusive, and transparent. The long-term stability, prosperity, and security in Afghanistan depend on a democratically elected government that reflects the will of the Afghan people. So I urge our colleagues to support this resolution as well. So, Mr. Chairman, in closing, I'd like to again thank you for holding this markup and look forward to working with you to advance all three of these measures.
Thank you, Mr. Engel. I will just ask if any of the members here seek recognition to speak on any of the en bloc amendments. Mr. Rohrabacher of California.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And let me thank you and the ranking member. Both you and the ranking member have provided such great leadership on this and the bipartisan positive spirit but that now, I think, dominates this committee reflects the hard work and the spirit that both of you have given to your job, and you do work really hard at this job, I know. So first to commend both of you on this, and of course I'm supportive of all three of the resolutions that have been brought before us. And let's take one note about North Korea. My father was a Korean War veteran, and I over the years, I had many talks with him about that particular conflict. I think what's interesting, that battle was 50 years ago. I remember, and I have mentioned that my father told me that he could not imagine that at that time, when he was a young man in Korea, that we would still have American military personnel stationed in Korea and doing a job, a military job in Korea. None of those guys who fought there felt that this was something that they were going to do to establish an American garrison overseas that would be there forever, and that their job forever would be to, and America's job would be, to be deterring action, hostile action on that peninsula. I would suggest the reason they are still there is because we have not taken those steps that are necessary to bring about a change of regime, if you would like to say, or a change in the situation in North Korea. We, in fact, over the years, have subsidized North Korea. And many of the people on the committee now don't remember those days. I do, in which we were spending millions of dollars providing food and energy to North Korea. That obviously has not worked. We need to understand that North Korea is a vicious dictatorship, and what we should be taking the steps that will permit, in some way, a unification of Korea, but under democratic government. And that means that we should be supporting people who will have an impact in North Korea, rather than just thinking we will keep our troops there for another 50 years. Today, we celebrate the 25th anniversary of Tiananmen Square, and celebrate, we commemorate, I should say, commemorate the Tiananmen Square. We didn't do the right thing there either, and we still have a dictatorship. There was a turning point 25 years ago that we could have sided with the people, and there was no price or penalty that the Chinese communist regime has paid for this monstrous obliteration of freedom at Tiananmen Square 25 years ago. Let's note that behind Korea, behind the government in Korea, is the government of China, the Communist Chinese Party of China. As a country, we should do more than just think that our policies need to focus on providing a garrison at a point in the world that might be some kind of an area, a volatile area like Korea. But instead, we should be thinking about the power of liberty and justice and democracy and the ideals that our country was founded upon, and start finding people in those other countries who will ally ourselves with those values and start supporting them. That's the way we should can bring about real change and not have to have our troops garrisoning various parts of the world. We appreciate again what your resolutions on Korea and Mr. Chairman, you've taken such a heartfelt position on this human trafficking, and we know that. And then again, Afghanistan. Thank you for those three pieces of hard work on you and Mr. Elliott's part today.
Well, thank you. Mr. Engel, I've been in North Korea, and our hearts go out to the people of North Korea in terms of what they've suffered through for the last three generations now of the dictatorship there, and our hope is that that situation will evolve into one where they have some modicum of human rights, some freedoms, some liberty, And it's our hope that between this legislation and what we passed a few weeks ago with respect to the revamping of the Broadcasting Board of Governors, that we might be able to better broadcast into North Korea the types of messaging which might lead to the pressures for a respect for human rights in that country. The result of how one treats one's own people is also indicative of how a regime will treat its neighbors, and that's one of the great problems for North Korea with respect to the horror of the human rights condition there. For those of us who have talked to those who have escaped out of the gulags, it is a numbing experience to hear people recount to you what you know, the types of stories we heard about concentration camps in the, you know, generations ago during the time of the Second World War and predating the war. To know that that happens today on a daily basis in North Korea, I think, is a heavyweight for all of us in the international community who feel some responsibility to try to do something about it to push the North Korea in the right direction. We now go to Mr. Albio Suris from New Jersey.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. I just want to express how refreshing it is to have a chairman and a ranking member that work so well together, and all the members. This is truly an atmosphere of partisanship, especially against such a leader in the world. And I want to commend the members participating in all the amendments. I support all three amendments. But I especially want to recognize my colleague, Congressman Connolly. He has been an outspoken member of this Congress against the North Koreans and their abuses, and his amendment today shows a great deal of sensitivity towards the 2 million Korean families that are in this country. So I thank you, and I thank my colleague for all his work.
Thank you, Mr. Suris. Any other members seeking recognition? Mr. Connolly.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I thank you and Mr. Engel for scheduling this markup. We talked on the floor, and I really appreciate your scheduling it. I thank you for your kind words, Mr. Engel, and yours as well, Mr. Suris. This legislation, I think, is an important symbol by the Congress that we're not going to stand idly by and allow the depredations and the unspeakable brutality of a regime that would make George Orwell pause in the systematic suppression of free thought, of freedom of any kind, in creating this system, state system, that has so degraded the human spirit. And whether it's the development of a nuclear capability or the fact, as you said, Mr. Chairman, that their own internal policies clearly reflect their external policies, and we've seen that, where they have engaged in provocative activity, they have actually engaged in acts of terrorism and violence against their neighbor in South Korea and others, and we must speak out. They have actually engaged, of course, in the, we talk about human trafficking today, a legislation I also enthusiastically support, that the North Korea regime has actually degraded itself to the point of abducting individuals as part of their policy. And this regime has to fall, and the United States, as I said, must be a beacon of hope and freedom for those who suffer under its oppression. You mentioned, Mr. Chairman, the gulags in North Korea. It's estimated as many as 200,000 North Koreans are being held against their will in such gulags. This is something we thought was over with the end of the Stalin period 60 years ago. And yet here it is, persistent in the 21st century. And so I think this legislation is important not only for what it does in tightening sanctions against that regime, but in sending the strongest message, I hope on a unanimous bipartisan basis by this Congress, that we will stand shoulder to shoulder with the people of North Korea in their aspirations and hopes for a freer future. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I also want to finally echo the comments of my friend, Mr. Rohrabacher of California. It is such a refreshing and and hopeful experience to come to this committee and see how work is conducted in a professional and bipartisan manner. I think it's a model for other committees in the Congress, and I commend you and your staff, Mr. Chairman, a delight to work with, and you, Mr. Engel, and your staff, similarly, a delight to work with. Thank you for your bipartisan leadership.
Thank you, Mr. Connolly. I think that, you know, when we speak about the Orwellian system there, the late Christopher Hitchens wrote a piece, Why Orwell Matters, but I think of all that he's written about totalitarian regimes, his story about his trip into North Korea is one of the most riveting you can read, and the nightmarish conditions there that people struggle under is a reminder that all of us in the international, you know, sphere have something to, some personal responsibility to make certain that we do all that we can do to see that some modicum of civilization comes to an area where people are beaten down the way they are in North Korea. I think Mr. Smith of New Jersey.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for bringing to the committee the North Korea Sanctions Enforcement Act of 2014. I think there is a very dangerous propensity, both in Congress and at the State Department, to think that North Korea is so bad, its violations of human rights so egregious, and its isolation makes it so that people are tempted to do very little or nothing to engage it and to seek to bring light and scrutiny to these horrific abuses that go on each and every day. In the past, Mr. Chairman, I've chaired four hearings on North Korean human rights, and we've actually heard from women who escaped from North Korea into China only to be trafficked once they got to China, and then when they were forcibly repatriated, they were put into the gulag system, which you call for an important study on, the 200,000 plus people who languish, not languish, they are tortured in those terrible gulags, and many of them have died. When you try to escape North Korea, it is considered treasonous, and as a direct result, those individuals are often tortured to death. I also want to thank you for, again, requiring that there be a comprehensive study about the gulag system. Again, we need to do more. We need to expose more. No tyrannical regime need be forever, and that goes for North Korea as well. And finally, I want to again thank the good work that Dr. King has done, the former staff director here, who has served very admirably and very effectively, but very much in an isolation as the ambassador to North Korea, ambassador on behalf of human rights with regards to that country. His job has to be as frustrating as it gets. He is not allowed to visit Pyongyang, but he does do a wonderful job in trying to keep the issue front and center. And again, he sat right over here on the other side of the aisle as the Democratic staff director for a whole lot of years. And let me express my deep respect for his work. And also, we got to keep, obviously, Kenneth Bay and his plight, the American who continues to be held in North Korea. And hopefully, this kind of legislation will become an additional prod to effectuate his release. So again, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I yield back to balance.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. We go now to Mr. Grayson, Florida.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This measure regarding the Afghan election, the second round, is an important one. On May 11th, 2013, in Kabul, the U.S. Deputy Secretary of State, William Burns, said that a successful political transition is an essential prerequisite for sustainable security. It is vitally important that the election held next April be transparent, credible, and inclusive. On July 9, 2013, the United States Senate unanimously agreed to a resolution stating that the government of Afghanistan is urged to ensure transparent and credible presidential and provincial elections in April of 2014 by adhering to internationally accepted democratic standards, establishing transparent electoral processes, and ensuring security for voters and candidates. In the first round of these elections, voter participation increased from approximately 35% in the 2009 presidential election to almost 60% in the election held in April, with the percentage of newly registered female voters slightly increasing. The 2009 Afghan presidential election experienced low female votes due to the insufficient number of female poll workers. and the UN Development Program's Law and Order Trust Fund for Afghanistan approved the Ministry of Interior request to fund the hiring of 13,000 female election security officers in order to bolster female voter turnout for the recent presidential election. Yet 40 out of Afghanistan's 407 districts still did not have female election staff due to security concerns. 27 Afghans were killed on Election Day in 2009, and 17 members of the Afghan National Security Forces were killed over the course of nearly 300 insurgent attacks carried out during the election held a few weeks ago. The 2009 Afghan Presidential Election Commission ordered results from the 2009 presidential election, the Independent Electoral Commission ordered results from 210 polling places to be invalidated, and later, after investigating 570 more polling stations quarantined by the IEC, found that all but 18 should be invalidated as well. In the recent election, 809,349 votes cast for the first presidential candidate, 165,339 votes cast for the second presidential candidate, and 39,555 votes cast for the third presidential candidate during the June 14, 2014 election have been invalidated for fraud. The Independent Electoral Commission has performed behind closed doors instead of in front of international monitors, and information from that commission was leaked to some candidates and not others. In addition to that, on the evening prior to the 2014 presidential election, until 5 p.m. on Election Day, the government of Afghanistan eliminated text messaging capabilities, and this greatly inhibited monitoring efforts by international organizations. The members of the National Democratic Institute were killed in an attack on the Serena Hotel in Kabul on March 20, 2014, causing NDI to remove significant numbers of staff from Afghanistan and spreading fear among other monitors. It's very important to understand that while some candidates and some campaign staff have proclaimed that should their opponents prevail, Afghanistan will be a less secure nation in which more civilians die, therefore creating a climate which is not conducive to democratic transition. Our resolution seeks to address these problems and to solve these problems in meaningful ways. In the advance of the presidential election now to be held off and scheduled for June 14th, we commend the Afghan people for completing the first round of a presidential election while at the same time urging them toward a credible, inclusive, and transparent second round. Great lengths were taken in the drafting of this measure to ensure that it focused solely on the impending election, an event on which the House of Representatives has yet to comment. This measure does not delve into such issues as the appropriate number of coalition forces in Afghanistan. Instead, what it does simply is commend the Afghan people simply for completing the first round of elections, albeit in a somewhat flawed fashion, and supporting the commissions responsible for ensuring fair, transparent, and fair voting. We encourage the government of Afghanistan to pursue measures that will increase female voter participation. We urge the government of Afghanistan to take all necessary steps to combat fraud during the election, including preserving the text messaging capabilities that the visitors and observers find so essential to be able to perform their functions properly. And we recognize the important role that Afghan National Security Forces, NATO forces, and currently American forces have had and will have in ensuring safety on voting day. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Grayson. We go now to Ms. Tulsi Gabbard of Hawaii.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I am in support of all three of the items that we are marking up today, but want to speak very briefly with connection to H.R. 1771, the North Korea Sanctions Enforcement Act. And like my colleagues, thank you and our ranking member for your leadership on this, and especially your remarks that opened up this conversation today. Much has been said very eloquently about the human rights violations that are occurring in North Korea, but specifically, the fact that strategic patience, the time for that has come and gone. We can talk about the threat that North Korea has to the region, that it is one of the primary causes of instability within the Asia-Pacific region. I was there in Japan, South Korea, and China last month, and heard in each of those three places, both from our military as well as folks on the ground there, that the threat that North Korea continues to provide is one of the most destabilizing factors inhibiting economic growth and opportunity in the region. But this is also something that hits very close to home. You mentioned the intercontinental ballistic missile tests, the continued growing capabilities of North Korea, and how every time we go through this cycle of threats and then some kind of talk of negotiations and finding a peaceful path through this, which ideally is what we all would like, North Korea's capabilities continue to grow. It is a great disservice to our country when North Korea makes threats that we have people here at home saying they're not close enough, or their threats are not serious, or they are not actually threatening the United States. They are actually threatening us very directly. States like mine in Hawaii do fall within the range of the ICBMs that they're developing. So when we talk about these, the need for stronger sanctions, the need to look back to the hard currency sanctions that have worked in the past, this is something that's very real, and it's very real to American citizens. It's very real to the military assets that we have in our own country, and is critical for our own national security and the safety of our people that we take this seriously and understand that this is a threat that is urgent today, not something that we can continue to wait and be patient on to deal with in the future. So I appreciate your leadership and your hard and thoughtful work on this. And on behalf of the people of my state in Hawaii, extend my gratitude. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Gabbard. We're going to go now to Mr. Ted Poe, Judge Ted Poe of Texas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for bringing all of these bills before the committee today. I'd like to speak specifically on H.R. 4449, the Trafficking Prevention Act, by Mr. Maloney. This requires training of State Department officials, and I wanted to emphasize the importance of the training to recognize, especially overseas, victims that are trafficked into the United States, specifically minor children, not only that we recognize who those children are, but we also need to have training. State Department officials need to have training on recognizing the problem of the demand, whether that demand occurs by Americans or someone else overseas for this scourge of human trafficking. So this is a good piece of legislation. Education and training on human trafficking is critical for us on a worldwide basis to stop this criminal conduct, this scourge, but also includes training to recognize the problem and the issue of the demand sector. And with that, I'll yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Poe. We go now to Mr. Joaquin Castro of Texas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you and Ranking Member Engel for including my amendment to H.R. 1771 in the en banc package. Recently a UN panel recommended that the international community must significantly improve enforcement of existing resolutions, particularly relating to cargo inspections at air and sea ports. Recognizing that there are enforcement gaps, my amendment urges the United States to strengthen the capacity of responsible nations to monitor and intercept shipments to and from North Korea that provide them cash, as well as technology and material for its nuclear and ballistic missiles program. I encourage my colleagues, of course, to support the amendment, and I thank you all for your support. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Castro. Hearing no further requests for recognition, the question occurs on the items considered en bloc. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. The measures are considered en bloc. That would be H.R. 4573, H.R. 4587, and House Resolution 600. They are agreed to as amended. And without objection, each of the measures as amended is ordered favorably reported as a single amendment in the nature of a substitute. Staff is directed to make any technical and conforming changes, and that concludes business for today. I want to thank our ranking member, Elliot Engel, and all of our committee members for their contributions and for their assistance, and this committee is adjourned.